Hello.
Hello, can you hear me?
I can hear you. How are you?
Great, how are you?
Yeah, not bad. Just enjoying the classic British weather.
Yeah.
Right. So you are Niko Wilhelm.
I'm Nico Wilhelm. Yeah, let's. You should be here in a second.
Okay. How long have we got with you guys at the moment?
15 minutes, I think.
15 minutes. Cool.
50 minutes, it says in our schedule, yeah.
Yeah. So while we wait for the others to come in, what I'll do is I'll ask you a question. And then once they jump in, I'll carry on with the next lot of questions as well, if that makes
Yeah.
sense. Okay.
Yes, you're gonna ask questions and I'm gonna answer.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. First of all, congratulations on winning UMK.
Thank you very much.
Here comes Joel.
Yeah.
Hey.
Hello.
Hello. So, yeah, first of all, congratulations on winning UMK. You won it by a massive landslide, it must be said. 500 votes compared to 100. It's remarkable. Tell us and talk us through your emotions during that night. It must be mixed emotions.
Like, it was pretty much just like energy and hype with us. Like, we were so concentrated in our own performance, we didn't really have time to think about anything else. But of course, like sitting on that couch, it was pretty much ups and downs. Like after the show, it was like, guys, we did it, we pulled the performance off, and it was really great. And then it's the they started counting the votes, and we were like, I think since the beginning, our idea was that, guys, we're gonna win this. But of
Yeah.
course, we were super surprised when we see like all the votes, how many there were, and we were like, it was better than we imagined, definitely.
Yeah, it was pretty insane in every way. But also like Nico said, we had the expectation for a win since we performed.
And of course, I mean, you have had history in participating in other competitions like Wacken Metal Battle Finland. Obviously, you'd won it and played at Wacken Open Air. So, in some respects, you would have that experience of in being in the competition as well. And after the winning the competition, the national selection, you must have partied hard, surely.
We
Of course, we
partied like for
party.
1 week. We're still tired about that partying, but we had to stop that because we have a work to do and we have to concentrate in sleeping and trying to keep our mind on the track with the Eurovision because the big thing is only about to come.
Well, yeah,
We
because
party when it's time to party, and then we work when it's time to work.
so has it already settled in with you guys that you are heading, hopefully, to Amsterdam, COVID dependent?
Like it was a big one to swallow, but I think yeah, and we're already started working for the performance in it's in Rotterdam actually, and yeah, we started like we've already started working. So yeah, it's kind of like even though we're really busy, we understand how big this is gonna get, and that's what we're preparing for.
Now, of course, metal hasn't had a huge representation with Eurovision. Obviously, 15 years ago, Lord, it won it for the fin for Finland for the first time. Obviously, you guys would love to emulate that victory by bringing Finland the second win as well. What does this mean for metal, though, in general? Do you think that metal is starting to creep more and more into Eurovision?
I think we're doing a huge favor for the whole scene. I mean, the rock and metal scene, we're doing a huge favor because it hasn't been in the mainstream just like it was like 15 years ago. It was a big thing mainstream. So basically, I would think about outside Eurovision as well because we are doing a huge favor. I mean, there's gonna be a lot more bands in the playlists and on the mainstream and on television and radio and everywhere because we just hit the mainstream with the rock song. So basically, and also in Eurovision, I can imagine that our success will at least in Finland, will pop up more bands on the competition.
I mean, speaking about success, your song Dark Side has already hit number one in Finland. Has it charted elsewhere in Europe?
Yeah, it's been streaming a lot in Germany and in France because it's been playlisted well there. But I don't think hitting the mainstream in Germany and outside like gas area is pretty hard compared to Finland. But I think after Eurovision, we have a chance to do that as well. And yeah, nothing is impossible like we all have seen right now. Everything is possible to happen. So I just keep my eyes open for everything.
Okay, from both of you, so Dark Side is a pretty much in-your-face kind of song, especially with the reference to the 27 Club, which, if people don't know, 27 Club is Kurt Cobain, Amy Winehouse, people who died from drugs and alcohol poisoning when they turned 27. What was the core inspiration behind this song? What inspirations did you take?
For Dark Side. For Dark Side, like, it was the moment in back in 2020, like, we released our third album, and a week from that, everything was like, the world was canceled. Like, the pandemic hit us. And then we were so pissed off, so frustrated back in our rehearsal place. And we felt like we wanted to throw our middle fingers up in the air and scream. But we figured that many people around the world must be feeling the same way. Mm. And we wanted to make an anthem for people that they can do that. And that was like way before any Eurovision or UMK ideas. And that was the important thing to us. And like the main thing in the main message we have with Dark Side is that, well, basically it's a party in the darkness meant for any people who feel like outsiders. That if you feel like a freak or an outsider, that you're just not good enough, welcome to the Dark Side. Everyone's invited to drinks on Blind Channel, all that stuff. And then there is definitely some dark references, dark humor, like with the 27 Club. Mm. But we also feel like that it's important to be able to talk about those things, because that's the worst thing in 2021, that people say that you can't like talk about anything. Well, if you feel like shit, you should talk about it. You should let it show, and then maybe someone can help you. But if you don't talk about those things, nothing's gonna happen, or something very bad is gonna happen. And we want to prevent that. And that's why we want to say, when you feel bad, it's okay to throw your middle fingers up in the air and scream, because that's good for people in times like this.
Yeah, exactly.
And I suppose in a way, with that message, that Dark Side is more than just a song. It's a reflection, like you said, of how the past 2 years have become, and so people can just stand up and scream their lungs out.
Yeah, it's kind of therapy for people. I would say that right now we're living in such a horrible world, and basically everyone is frustrated about everything. So I would say that the world is ready for this kind of shit coming up. But yeah, let's see how it goes in Eurovision. I have a good feeling about that. And I think there's a lot of people that can feel the same way and relate to us.
I mean, arguably Eurovision, apart from the song itself, the staging is also what makes some performances stand out massively. Obviously, not last year because obviously the COVID, but the year before, Hatari from Iceland, they brought a whole new spectacle to Eurovision. How will Blind Channel bring a stage performance to the set? What have you got planned in mind already?
We love the energy, like in the UMK, the energy like started from us. We don't want to bring any big toys or something like that, because that takes the attention away from us. Like, it looked like our live show, and we like that. We want all the energy to come from us, the way we perform. And then what we love is the pyrotechnics and the bombs in the stage, not only because they look amazing on television, but because they feel amazing on stage. When there's like fire all around you and you feel the pressure of the bombs, it makes us perform like better. We're more fierce in a way. So that's what we want to like add up to the Eurovision show.
And also we're going to do cool things with the, there's going to be a lot of screens on the floor and on the walls. So we're going to do a lot more things with those ones. And, but yeah, the whole show is will be about us performing energetically, just like we did on UMK. So we don't want to mess up with the staging too much compared to UMK. It's going to be a pretty similar but upgraded version of that.
Now, you guys call your music Varna Pop. When I actually analysed Dark Side, I noticed there was new metal, gothic metal, post-hardcore, electronic music. There's this whole cauldron of music going on. How did you guys come up with the term Varna Pop?
Like, it was 8 years ago, the band had just started and we needed to promote our songs to local radio stations. And we needed a way to describe our music. And new metal felt too old-fashioned. It had this vibe that we're late, because the new metal bands had already gone up. And then alternative rock, like, that's the most boring way to describe your music. That doesn't say anything about your music. We needed something simple, but that grabs the feeling we had. And that was like, our music is basically, it's rock music with mainstream touch. Mm. And we felt like Violent Pop captures that pretty well. And during the years, it has become more than just a genre. It has become like a brand to us. It's our brand, and it's the thing like we're gonna keep doing. Rock music aiming for the mainstream audiences. That's Violent Pop.
Yep.
With the song Dark Side, will this be a standalone single, or are you looking to bring this onto an eventual EP or album in the future?
We're gonna do our third album. It's gonna be released next year. That's a promise.
There you go, Blind Channel fans. You heard it here. Joel just said there's a new album coming out for you next year.
Next year.
Okay. And after Eurovision, aside from obviously the album itself, have you got any plans, all depending on COVID?
Well, we're gonna tour as much as possible, as soon as possible. We just have to live day by day and see how this pandemic all around the world turns out. But of course, we miss the shows. We miss our interacting with our fans like directly. So aside an album, that's one thing.
Now, see, a lot of bands have their own ways of getting into Eurovision. What made you decide to go into Eurovision? Was it literally on the strength of the song that you had?
I would say if you ask about the reasons why we got into UMK or Eurovision, well, basically the main reason was that everything was cancelled and we had to figure out how to keep ourselves on the grind and keep our thing active and stuff like that. So when we heard that UMK is really searching for some rock or heavy music, we were like, now it's our time to hit that competition. And now everything is cancelled and will be cancelled for a long time. So why not? Just let's go and smash that shit up. And we made it.
Yeah, and we had a couple of, we always have like songs ready, but we knew immediately that Dark Side was the song we wanted to show to the world during this time.
Okay, and finally, have you got any greetings or thank yous wish to send out to your friends, family, people within the industry who've helped you through this amazing journey that you've embarked on?
Well, thank you
very much.
Keep joining the Dark Side and hit your friends about this thing and see you in Rotterdam. I think we need you all to vote us and make the thing happen as big as possible.
And we can't wait to be back in UK.
Yeah, we'll love that.
As long as we're nice with you guys. All right. Cheers. Stay metal.
Cheers. You too.
See ya.
See ya.
Bye-bye.